Very hot day, very warm evening here in California, and all the little bugs are singing their song tonight, just out here listening to them. It's very entertaining. We have some very important ground to cover here. Didn't think I'd be taping today because yesterday was so incredible. What could I possibly add? Well, just this evening, something did get added on to it, and it's like, holy cow. Can I even say that, you know? Let's get into it by taking the analogy of a dream. Let's say we're in a dream, having a dream. We're asleep, dreaming, in bed. And, you know, we see we're on the beach and the waves are coming up and smashing the cliffs. And we're thinking, oh my gosh, we're trying to climb up the cliffs. And then suddenly we're, you know, driving a car through some street, just kind of cruising around through the countryside. And then we shift over, you know, to when we were fishing in a lake, you know. And then we're up in a rocket going up into space. And these dreams keep going on like that. Now, let's ask the question. Is the consequence of being near the ocean with those waves coming in any different than the consequences of driving down a road in the countryside or fishing in a lake or going up into space? Are those consequences any different? Any different? Now let's say that rocket ship, you're up in space and it starts coming back down to the atmosphere and you're in that, and it's plunging into the ocean. You're going, oh my gosh, I'm going to die. And then suddenly, just before you hit the ocean, you find yourself in another scenario. You're walking down a street somewhere, visiting a friend or something. Is that consequence of almost hitting the ocean different than walking down the street to your friend's house? Are there any real consequences in a dream is the question. And is one consequence different than the other? Now, let us say you are near the ocean and these waves are coming in and threatening you and you're climbing up the cliff and they keep smashing in and you say, oh my gosh, I better pray. And you say, God, please help me. I'm about to die. This is terrible. These terrible waves are coming. Let's see. Okay. Now, in that dream, you're praying for a consequence to change. But we just saw that in a dream, all consequences are equal. They're equally nothing. There aren't any real consequences in a dream. So what would we would be praying for? Now let's see, say we are on that cliff, you know, and the waves are smashing and getting higher and higher. We're pray for something, and suddenly, like, what happens? Someone throws a rope down to you. There's someone up there, and a rope comes down. You grab a hold of the rope, you know, and they get pulled up the cliff, and whew, you're so happy you're saved. Safe from death there. Okay. And we say, ah, God saved us from death, from a terrible consequence there. What just happened? We see all consequences in a dream are all equally nothing. And yet, when we're having this bad dream, frightening dream, we're praying for something in the dream to help us get free us from that consequence. Save us from that consequence. So we're thinking in the dream, we think this consequence is real. And we need something in the dream to save us from it. Now let us say we're on that cliff, climbing the cliff and the waves are coming in. You know, and you know, we're peril, in great peril. And then something, our alarm goes off and we wake up. They say, oh, that was a bad dream, and we got to get up and take a shower, get some breakfast off to work. Are we thinking about the dream? Are we thinking about the consequences of the dream? Are we thinking about praying in the dream to God to save us from the consequence? No, we are realize the stuff in the dream was of no consequence whatsoever. So, we have here in this world certain, I call them ambassadors of reality, who come into the world, and they have a very different take on this world than we do. and some of them I've had the privilege of being in contact with and knowing what they're like. And the funny thing is they have this high indifference, and they say that all consequences here in the world are equal. They say that living, to live and to die, it's all exactly the same. So they're acting just like the scenario that we brought up, as if all this was a dream and doesn't have any consequence at all. They're acting just like that. Just like if we were aware of someone else's dream, okay? If we were somehow aware of someone else's dreams, and they're going through all these dreams, and sometimes they're in peril, and they're praying, God, save me from this dream. This ocean's going to drown me. And we said we would think, huh, why isn't this dreamer just wake up? Why are they praying to God to save him from this ocean when all they have to do is wake up and realize there is no ocean there. There is no danger there. So we would say, we would have an attitude of just, all this dreaming is inconsequential. Everything that happens in a dream is equally inconsequential. And we would simply be saying, hey, you know, tap him on the sleeper on the shoulders, and hey, wake up. Come on, wake up. We wouldn't be responding to the dream, what's in the dream. We wouldn't be whispering in their ear, you know, hey, you need to pray to God to save you from that ocean. You know, that ocean's terrible. It's going to kill you. Pray to God. Come on. You know, we'd be saying, hey, you're only dreaming there's an ocean. You're only dreaming you're in peril. You don't need to make any prayers to God. Just wake up from the dream. Because when you're making prayers to God in a dream, you're reinforcing the belief that the dream is real and that there are real consequences to the dream. And that's what these great ambassadors of truth tell us. They say simply wake up from the dream. Realize who's the one that is dreaming. And they act as if all consequences in the world are equal. And that is a mind-blowing thing, isn't it? Because what it really means, as we are praying to whatever we pray to, please help us, please. I'm so sick, I'm so poor, I'm so problems, terrible consequences here. As praying to a God, to some to save us from these terrible consequences, we are literally reinforcing the belief that all this is real. It's not a dream. It's real. These consequences are real, and that there's some real power in the dream that can defeat these consequences, the bad part of the dream. And we need to pray and ask for this power to come in and save us from this bad consequences of the dream. So it's a double problem. One, we're reinforcing that we think that this, all of this is real, that a dream is real, okay? Two, we're believing that within this reality, there's some other power that can come in and change the reality, change the outcome, change the consequences fundamentally, and defeat the dynamics of this dream and such, you know. So what we really have to say, as shocking as it is I have said before that the God that the world prays to, that the power that God, the world prays to, is a God of belief. It is what belief believes to be God. It is what belief believes to be a power. Okay. It is not the real God at all. The true prime creator will only tell you, wake up from the dream. You're just dreaming. You're just imagining. Choose a different scenario instead of dreaming. Choose a scenario of being awake. That's all. So we are praying to what belief believes to be God. And we're asking what belief believes we should be asking, which is to, as I've said in other videos, some hero, you know, some power, some hero which can come into this dream and defeat, you know, the bad consequences, the evil, the wickedness, destroy it, get rid of it. And we're hoping, you know, eventually we'll be able to get rid of it forever. What we don't realize is this is exactly what the dream is set up to orchestrate. We're actually being deceived when we do that. We're reinforcing belief. And we're reinforcing the purpose of belief. The purpose of belief is to believe that one causal agent can come in and wipe out another causal agent, that can undo the effects of it, that can interfere. And to do that would literally mean that we can wipe out reality. All reality can be wiped out. And that's exactly what this dream, the intention of this dream is to develop the capacity to destroy reality so we can then force the Prime Creator to change reality and make us Prime Creator. So we, as we are praying to God in this dream, in this our imagination, to save us, to get rid of these negative, bad consequences we don't want, we are falling head over heels into this trap. Head over heels. The ambassadors of truth that have been sent to the world from the grace of God, by the grace of God, they have this complete high indifference where whatever happens, it's all the same to me. Whatever happens here makes no difference. It's all the same. Exactly as we would, the attitude we would have if we were aware of some sleeper's dreams and we were seeing these dreams and we would just say to the sleeper, hey, I'm not reacting to any of these dreams. They're all exactly the same to me. They're all unreal. Why should I even react to them at all? Exactly the same attitude. Which should tip us off that this all is a dream. This is all our simply a dream of imagination. It has no real consequences whatsoever. The ambassador Ananda Mayama used to say that life and death were to her were exactly the same. No difference. If someone would die, she'd say, well, why are you crying? Why are you upset? She goes, it's the same thing. There's no difference between the living body and the body being dead. It's all a dream. It's just a dream. So why is there some, you know, she's reacting as if there's some terrible difference there. There's not. That high indifference sees it's all a dream. And there's nothing real taking place at all. There's nothing being threatened at all in this dream. Now, so the very highest way to be in this world is the high indifference, is to see no consequences to anything in the world taking place, to not pray for any change of consequence, to be indifferent, totally indifferent to any particular consequence, do not be praying for a change in consequence. And this has an amazing effect. Let's go over that. Let's say you have an illness or sickness, you don't feel well. Instead of praying, I gotta get well, you should try to say attitude of, I have no expectation, no prayer, no desire for anything to happen here. Now let's say you were a sleeper and you're dreaming. Now, what if in the dream, when that ocean waves are smashing against the cliff and you're about ready to be dragged away into this raging ocean, you would say, I have no desire for any consequence whatsoever to take place. I have no desire for any expectation, any consequence of any kind to take place. What would happen if you don't have any desire for any consequence? You wouldn't be waiting for any consequence, would you? Not even for any bad consequence to happen. You wouldn't be waiting for the good consequence. You wouldn't be waiting for the bad consequence. Therefore, you wouldn't be waiting for someone to throw a rope down and save you. And you wouldn't be waiting for the waves to come in and sweep you away to your death either. You wouldn't be waiting for anything to happen. And when you're in that condition, what happens? You wake up from the dream. That is what happens. So, to be wise, and we need to be wise right now, is to simply abide in this attitude of, I am not desiring any consequence to take place whatsoever. Good, bad, indifferent, no. I'm not expecting, desiring, wanting any consequence. I have no interest in anything of consequence whatsoever. Pure indifference. High indifference is called. And to try that instead of praying to God, saying, help me, God, help me. That only reinforces the belief that these consequences are real, okay? The prayer that the true Prime Creator, which is beyond belief, would ask you to pray is to pray for this high indifference. Pray for the attitude of not wanting any consequence whatsoever here in this world. And that is the prayer that will wake you up from this dream. And you will realize then the I am presence of isness. That is identity. You become aware of that and you abide in that, presented by unconditional love, the perfect overlay. That is how you get to it. How you don't get to it, how you don't wake up, is to desire some outcome in existence, some consequence. Another way of putting it is, don't pray for any outcome. Be neutral in any outcome. He says, and not that any outcome is okay. You just have no desire for any particular outcome at all. No interest in any outcome at all. And when you're dreaming, that is the right attitude to have. Because the outcome you really want is to awaken from that dream. But you cannot awaken from the dream as long as you're desiring some outcome in the dream, because you'll be waiting for that outcome. So I know this is like mind-blowing, you know, to our expectations, to our belief system. It is mind-blowing to our belief system. But that's my purpose here, is to say these things that blow the mind of our belief system. Our belief system's just like, you know, just, whoa. It's how you go beyond belief. Do not desire any outcome, any particular outcome at all here. Not that you know, any good outcome, any bad outcome, any indifferent outcome, all the same, you have no desire for any outcome. Any outcome. And the outcome of that is awakening from the dream, realizing that you are the dreamer of the dream, knowing who the dreamer of the dream is, knowing that it's isness, that it's nowness, that it's invulnerability, that it's the living light. And this just came to me, you know, like several hours ago. Just, I was in the kitchen, making a salad or something, and it's just like, wow, oh my gosh, you know, I have to say this, I have to say, don't pray to God for some consequence. Are you kidding? Are you kidding? You know, wonder why people, when I was young, said, I'm too audacious, you know, they said, you just are too much. And even the spiritual people here in the world, they said, you're so spiritual, but you're too much. You're just too much. You've got to tone it down. You've got to study religious history. You got to study and find out, you know, what you should really say. You know, in other words, you need to follow the religion of belief. That's what everybody said. Because I would just say, hey, no, you're doing it all right. You're praying to God. You're praying for a consequence. That's going to keep you, enmesh you even more in the dream, because you'll believe that consequences are real in the dream, and therefore you feel that you need to defeat, you know, the evil in the dream, which makes makes you believe that there's some separate causal agent in the dream attacking another causal agent, which reinforces your belief that it's possible to attack reality, and it just makes things worse and worse and worse for you. And yet, of course, we have the tradition on this planet is to pray to a deity for better consequences in the dream, right? That is the whole story, right? Except for the ambassadors of reality that have come here. They don't say that at all, really. Not really. You know, sometimes they agree with insanity to a certain extent, and then they work with you to say, hey, you know. But what they're really saying is, don't pray for any consequences here. Don't pray for any outcome. Be indifferent to any outcome, any consequence, and stop praying for an outcome. Stop desiring an outcome, because you'll be waiting in the dream for it instead of awakening. If you're not waiting for anything in a dream, you wake up. You wake up. The dream loses its hold on you. The only hold the dream has on you is you're waiting for an outcome in that dream. That's it. When you're no longer waiting for an outcome, the dream comes to an end. So I'm recovering my audaciousness that I used to have, and that people would said was too much here. Of course, belief is going to say that. And I've said 99.9% of all the spiritual teaching on this planet is based on belief instead of what's beyond belief. It's based on what we believe is true. It's based on putting words in God's mouth. We assume, we put the words in God's mouth that God wants us to pray to God for a different outcome. That's just our belief. That's a trick. That's what's deceiving us. God is not saying that. God is saying, don't pray for any outcome. And therefore, you won't be waiting for any outcome. And therefore, you will awaken and realize, oh my gosh, this has all just been a play of my imagination. A dream hasn't affected reality at all. Has not affected reality in the slightest bit. And I am the eternal. I am presence is eternal. It is right now and always will be right now. Needs no future to be what is. Needs no outcome to be what it is. Needs no belief to be what it is. We have to awaken to this fact. And as long as we're waiting for an outcome in a dream, we will not awaken. We will not awaken. Because we're waiting for that outcome. We're waiting for God to answer our prayers with an outcome in the dream. To make our circumstances, make our outcome better. Better, you see. We're waiting for things to get better. We're waiting for peace to come to the world. We're waiting for enlightenment to happen. You know, even praying for enlightenment is waiting for something to happen. Don't pray for enlightenment. Don't even pray for awakening. Pray for indifference to all outcomes. Pray for indifference to all outcomes. That is the only focus which will truly awaken you. Because you're not waiting for any outcome. You're not even waiting for your awakening in the dream. Because the awakening we're praying for is an awakening in the dream. It's not a true awakening at all. It's an outcome in the dream. It's a consequence in the dream. And so we're praying we want to be, you know, awakened in the dream, so to speak. That's not awakening. That's not awakening. That's still our imagination. That's still our belief. We can believe we're awakened. So we can pray for an enlightenment that we can believe in. That's not enlightenment. We can pray for awakening that we can believe in. That is not awakening. That's still dreaming. And that's actually making things worse. It's making things worse. Because it's believing that some causal agent, some external causal agent can come into the effects of another causal agent and nullify those effects. Which, if that were true, reality would be completely nullified. Because the very principle of reality is each purpose idea has its effects as one with it, and they can never be separated from it. They cannot. There can never be a causal agent come into the effects of another causal agent and change it, you know. It's impossible. If that were true, reality would be nullified entirely. So the crazy thing is that all our efforts, even praying to God for enlightenment, is actually our desire to nullify reality and thereby threaten reality so bad that the Prime Creator will change reality for us. That is literally true. And this is a shocking, amazing, you know, truth that very few want to say. Very few want to say this because it goes against all the belief in this, and, you know, entire history of this planet. And in much of the universe too. But intuitively, you can understand what's being said because there's something within you that is beyond belief and you know it. And that part of you which is beyond belief will say, aha, I'm glad someone finally said that. That's what I've been waiting to hear, but no one will say it. No one will say it because when you say that, 99.9% of the world and the whole history of the planet is going to say that you're completely wrong and that you're crazy and what you're saying is terrible, etc. How could you're you know, blasphemous, heretical? How can you be against God and all prayer and all this stuff? But I have pointed out very clearly here what's really going on. What's really going on is that is how we reinforce our belief in the dream, is we are praying for an outcome, a change in outcome in the dream. Don't pray for any change of outcome whatsoever. Don't pray for any consequence or outcome at all. Make that your prayer. Say, God, give me the grace to not pray for any outcome at all in this dream. Now, the great ambassadors of truth tell us if our path is service, to simply serve all equally without any attachment to any outcome. Okay, selfless service. Just serve each one as if they were God, and don't pray for any outcome at all. That is a way to get to this truth. That is a very profound spiritual path, actually. I realize that today, too. Because when you do that, you're just a servant of everyone. You're giving up your desire for an outcome in this world, really. And that will awaken you. You'll get to the point where you will literally have no desire for any outcome. Good or bad or indifferent, doesn't matter. And then the dream ends. You awaken from it. And then you realize, oh my gosh, I've only been dreaming, and I'm this wonderful, perfect being of isness that is just absolutely wealthy, infinitely wealthy. You know, I have everything. I never lost anything, and nothing I have has ever been harmed and never can be harmed. And you realize that. And you realize you've just been dreaming this crazy dream. So you're not going to hear very often this sort of teaching, this type of advice, sharing of advice here, of what to do, how to awaken from the dream. Do not pray for any consequences, any outcome, and then you won't be waiting for one, you see? You won't be waiting. You won't be waiting for the ocean to stop. You won't be waiting for it to come at you harder. You won't be waiting for someone to rescue you. You won't be waiting to die. You won't be waiting to panic. Nothing. No, you know, the next part of the dream, you're not waiting for it anymore. You're not expecting any outcome. You don't desire any outcome to take place, any consequence whatsoever. Stay the same, change, it's all the same. You're not desiring any outcome. How can you keep dreaming under those circumstances? How can you keep dreaming? Cannot. That's how you awaken. And so this is October 1st, 2012. And this just popped into my mind, like, wow, saw it as clear as a bell, you know, wow. And I said, I can't say that. Can I say that? I asked myself, can I say these things? I said, boy, I don't know. That's hitting close to home, isn't it? It's really hitting close to home. And again, the key to any spiritual path, the path of awakening from the dream, is simply to check in first and feel intuitively, am I okay with this? And if you feel, you know what, I feel like I'm okay with this, you got it. You know, that's the part of you that's already awake and saying, yeah, I'm okay with that. And then you have to look at belief and realize belief is not okay with it. Then you go, okay, I'm okay with belief not being okay with it. That's fine. That's fine. So I'm saying, you know what? I'm okay with 99.99% of the world and all of history, 99.99% of all history, to not be okay with this. I'm okay with that. That's fine. Because I know it's true. I know it's true. So I say, okay. And you can be like that too. You say, okay, I'm okay with it. I don't have to be, you know, screaming and pressing it, you know, on just everybody I meet and say, hey, this is the truth, this is the truth, this is the truth. No, you say, okay, you realize that most are not at the point of seeing this. They are still desperately working and praying for outcomes, which just binds them to the dream because they're waiting, expecting and waiting for outcomes in the dream, which keeps them asleep. The dreamer isn't going to awake when they're still desiring outcomes in the dream. They're going to keep on dreaming. They're going to keep on dreaming. When the dreamer gives up any desire for any outcomes in the dream, that's when the dream stops. They say, ah, that was just a dream. (clears throat) So it does mean what you think it means. It means awakening from the dream, and it also means that we are binding ourselves to this dream through the very means that we're trying to use, trying to make us feel better in the dream. We're actually binding ourselves to it. That's how tricky and diabolical this dream is. It's very diabolical. It's very tricky. The more you try to improve the dream, the deeper your sleep is. The more you're pursuing out, more that you are pursuing outcomes in a dream, the deeper your sleep is. The more you are petitioning God to change the dream for you, the deeper you fall asleep. And of course, that's the very path that most are taking. And they wonder, you know, how come I, you know, I keep suffering. The dream is a dream of suffering. It is. It's a dream of threat. That's why it's a dream of suffering. It's a dream of vulnerability. It's a dream of fear. It's a dream of death. It's a dream of loss, a dream of sickness, a dream of terror, all of those things. That's what it is. Because it's an attempt to act out so that it manufacture through acting out a way to threaten reality and destroy reality. And so we're just, this dream is acting that whole scenario out hypothetically. And so, of course, it's terrifying. It's absolutely terrifying. And of course, as we're being terrified, we're saying, oh my God, help, please save me, save me, save me, you know. And it's very difficult when you're in that situation in the dream to understand what to do. Which is why it is super crucial that there be these ambassadors of truth and reality come into the world and just sit here and let us get used to it. There's something different here. Just get used to it. Just hang out. You say, I know there's something different here. Really, there's something different. I'm not sure what it is, but I realize they're not dreaming. They're not asleep. There's something very different, profoundly different. And then you gradually get clued in. You start getting clued in. And then eventually you will suddenly see, oh my gosh, you know, it's been my praying for outcomes that has been binding me to this dream all along. And by giving up any desire for any outcome at all, that's how I awaken. So all my prayers, I've been praying nonstop my whole life, give me better outcome. And it's like, these prayers don't work. I keep suffering. What's going on? And then you pray even more. You see, and they're suffering. You know, a lot of times you see people who pray a lot, they got so many problems. So many problems. And you see those who seem so unattached to any outcomes, and they seem so, you know, like light, you know, like they're waking up. That's why. That is why. And those who are praying for outcomes, they don't realize that they're only deceiving themselves. They're deceiving them. They don't realize it. I didn't realize it. And how do they realize it? How do we realize this? How do we see it? It's, you know, as long as we're referencing the dream, we don't see it. We do not see it. That's why we need something within this dream that is awake, that is not dreaming, which is to remind us that, hey, stop praying for outcomes. That's the problem. You don't need to change outcomes in a dream. You need to awaken from a dream. Okay? Again, this dream is a dream of suffering, a misery, of loss. We've gone over that. So as long as you keep waiting for outcomes in a dream, you're going to keep getting pummeled. You're going to keep getting beaten up. You're going to get beaten up by everything. You know, blows are just going to come at you like that in all different directions, angles. And it's going to keep on bashing you like that. And you're going to die and die and die and die and die. Get sick, get abandoned, lose this, lose that. And you're going to suffer terribly. And that's just going to fuel this praying more and more. Hey, God, help me out. Hey, God, change my consequences. Hey, God, change my consequences. And that's just going to perpetuate. It's pouring gasoline on the fire is what it is. There was another teacher, an ambassador of reality of some degree. I don't know exactly how much. Franklin Merrill Wolf in California. And he had the same thing, high indifference. He was in the state of high indifference at a certain point in his life. He called it the high indifference, which is, I mean, total indifference to anything that's happening here, not praying for any consequences whatsoever. So those who awaken, they understand it. They see that. They see, this is just a dream. And all the praying for consequences was binding me to the dream. That doesn't mean... It means you know God instead of believing in God. People say, it means you don't believe in God. Yeah, that's right. It means we know God. That's what it will mean, that we know God, not believe in God. Belief doesn't know God, can never know God, because belief believes that reality can be changed. Therefore, can't possibly know God, because God is reality, and reality cannot be changed. So belief can never know God. Can only dream. So in October, we're establishing momentum. And this is a game changer. This is a game changer. Because now we see the root of momentum, right? Which is to pray, to give up any prayer for changing consequences, for outcomes. To pray, to give up our prayer, as it were. It's still a prayer. It's the ultimate prayer. It's the prayer that awakens us from the dream. All other prayers bind us. The prayer to drop all prayer, drop all desire for any help and change in consequences, from any help from the dream, from anywhere, any desire for a change of outcome, change of consequence, for any consequence, any outcome at all. Pray for that. And so you're not abandoning prayer, you're just using the correct prayer. You're not abandoning God, you're just abandoning your belief in God so you can know God. Okay. So this is a very auspicious day to be able to say these things, share these things freely so anyone in the world can hear it. It is a very auspicious thing. Because it goes counter to all belief in this world. Entirely counter to all belief. Everything that we've practiced, all the traditions. Those who have awakened have realized this very fact and have prayed that they not pray for any outcome whatsoever. That's what they've prayed. Eventually, you might have someone with a lifetime of prayer, and finally they realize, aha, I only need to pray for no prayer for consequences or outcomes whatsoever. And then, wow, the divine grace, the unconditional love, they're suffused by this, gently suffused by it. And then we say, wow, this one is, God has blessed them. And we wrongly think that it's their lifetime of prayer that God finally answered. No, it's that they finally made the right prayer. That's what happened. So we think we need to spend a lifetime in prayer, to devout prayer, and eventually God will answer our prayers. That's not true. We can spend an entire lifetime praying for outcomes, praying for the world, not even for us. I'm talking about praying for any outcome at all, meaning anything in the world at all. People are sick, people are dying, people are struggling, tragedies, whatever. Don't pray for any outcome for anything in the whole universe. Do not desire any outcome to take place. In any way. You don't desire for a bad outcome, negative attack outcome. You don't desire for a good outcome. You're not praying for any outcome at all. Not just for yourself, for everyone and for the whole world. Not only now but in the future. You're not praying for, and when you're praying for no outcome, you're dropping the future, right? You are literally dropping the future. And when you drop the future, you're dropping the dream. You drop the dream, you will experience the I am presence of isness. The overlay of unconditional love that overlays everything that belief has dreamed up. All the consequences that belief has dreamed up and imagined. So real spiritual sadhanas, real spiritual practice is to get to that prayer and be able to pray that prayer. Say, God, Prime Creator, I pray that I don't pray for any outcome. My prayer is for no outcome I'm not praying for any outcome whatsoever. I'm free of all desire from any outcome to take place. What does that do? Put you right here, right now, with no past, no future. You've dropped the past because the past are all the outcomes, you know. Memories of all the outcomes. You're not interested in even remembering any outcome. The future is all the hope for outcomes. And when you drop any desire for any outcome, you drop both the past and the future. Because you're not referencing the past looking for outcomes. You know, we reference the past like, what kind of outcome do I want the future to give me? And so you look at the past and you're thinking, okay, maybe I can improve a little bit on that. But if you're praying for no outcome at all, no desire for any outcome, you don't need the past to reference, and you don't need the future for any outcome to take place. So you've dropped time and you've stepped beyond time, just like that. And by stepping beyond time, you step beyond belief simultaneously. It's the same thing. Because you're believing that you need these outcomes. You need the outcomes to change. That's the dream, isn't it? You want outcomes to change. You want outcomes to be taking place. But if you pray, I have no interest, no desire in any outcome. The only moment that leaves is right now, where isness can be felt, is felt. That's where it is, because isness doesn't need any outcome to be what it is. It's not trying to threaten reality, so it doesn't need any outcome. Everything's perfect already. When everything's perfect, why do you need some kind of outcome to change, something to change? You don't. You don't need any change. So you don't need a past. You don't need a future. You don't have any past where you've been working on changes, where stuff has changed, reinforcing the belief in the future, that you can change stuff in the future. You don't need past or the future. So the momentum is coming now. It is coming. These things are being shared. And when you see it this way, you just say, of course. That's very simple. It's also, to the world, it's like unbelievable. It is unbelievable. Just like when I was young, people say, you say the most unbelievable things. If you could just make it believable to me, I'll believe you. And I said, I don't want you to believe me. I want you to know what is true. No, go beyond belief. I don't want you to believe me. And they say, well, if I can't believe you, then I can't. How can I possibly even listen to you if I can't even believe you? See? Because, you know, it's not about believing what's being said. It's about knowing what's being said and being okay with it and realizing this is coming from beyond belief. It's not coming from belief. So you can say, yeah, of course I don't believe this. How can anyone believe it? You don't believe it, but you know it. You know it. So don't agree with your adversary, you know, which is belief. When belief says, I don't believe this at all, I say, yeah, of course you don't believe it. That's fine. I don't expect you to believe it. I don't expect anyone to believe anything's being said here. But you know that it's true. You know it. Intuitively, there's something within you that knows it and says, ah, yeah, right. I've been waiting for outcomes. I've been praying for outcomes and therefore waiting for outcomes. Wow. And then you realize, you say, oh my gosh, I can awaken from this dream. I have the tool to awaken. And then you know you will awaken from the dream. You know it. Just one moment. And that's where I'm at right now. I'm seeing this and saying, oh my gosh. All my life I've had this feeling of waiting. That's the dream. Waiting for something to change in the dream. Once you no longer expect any consequences, you're not asking for any consequences or changes, there's no more waiting. And you awaken to the dream. It doesn't matter if you're you know, being swept away by the ocean. When you awaken from that dream, there is no more ocean. There is no more vulnerable body. There is no more of that scenario. It's poof, gone. Nothing's happening. It's disappeared. Just like when you awaken in the morning, like mist, the dream just kind of evaporates into nothing. So even if you're in a bad situation in the world and your future looks bleak, which mine does, you don't need to change that, because you're going to awaken from that and then realize there's no consequence to it. And then, you know, there are things we need to work out down the road, of course, and we will. Because when you awaken from the dream, it softens everything in the dream, because it cannot ensnare you. It says, whoa, I better go back to square one, you know, and make everything seem real nice and no threat. Otherwise, I'm not going to be able to trick this one, you know. And by that softening of the dream, your practical, pragmatic situation becomes guided, full of grace, and everything happens for your benefit, actually. So, you know, if you have what you know, a sick body or bad finances and troubles and all this stuff, those can ease up. They'll ease up. Everything will ease up. Everything will ease up on you. But you don't do that by praying for a cure for your sickness. If you have cancer, don't pray for a cure. Pray for indifference to any outcome. You're not praying for an outcome that you stay sick. You're not praying for an outcome that you get well. Okay? You're not praying for anything. You're praying for desiring no outcome. No consequences. No change in outcome. No outcome. Not praying for any particular outcome. Doesn't matter what it is. None. Zero. Zero outcomes. When you have that, suddenly, what can happen except you awaken? Because even staying sick is an outcome. Getting better is an outcome. Everything that can happen in a dream is an outcome. And if you're not praying for any of that, there is no more dream. There is no more dream. You awaken. And then once you awaken, you see, the dream then says, whoa. It says the purpose is destructivity and threat. That sick body is a form of showing, you know, threat, destruction. The dream will have to back off of that scenario. Back off for it. It'll back off. And we'll say, wait a minute, I better get this one well again, because, you know, they're not praying for any consequences and there's something wrong. I better get them really well and then have to attack them again later. But right now, this attack thing isn't working. It's not working the way I want it to. And you'll get well, and you can literally get well like that in an instant. Theoretically, that is very true. That's very true. You can, in an instant, you can be healed of anything. And you can even raise from the dead. That is true also. That's absolutely true. If there is an attitude of not praying for any outcome whatsoever, okay, which means like being saved from death, being resurrected from death, no outcome whatsoever. If that's the attitude, your body can literally resurrect. That is true. That is very true. Because all of this is a dream. So anything can happen. A dream, it's all reversible. And belief can back off so strong, can even back off death and say, wait, this death didn't work. And you'll come back to life. That is true. Very true. There's nothing in this dream that can't be reversed, because the whole thing is just imagination. Imagination can just imagine that's backing off of it. See? Because it says, wait, you're not praying for any outcome. You're not, and you're going to wake up and saying, what it believes is that you've stopped praying for any outcome. It doesn't know you're awake. It doesn't know that. But it believes you've stopped praying for any outcome. You're not waiting for any outcome. And therefore, the dream isn't working. And it feels like the dream's going to be annihilated. So belief backs off the threat, backs off death, backs off sickness, backs off scarcity, backs off poverty, backs off everything. You can be left in a paradise, actually, if you drop any desire, prayer for any outcome to take place at all. So you're not waiting for anything. Belief can back off everything and just imagine a paradise temporarily. But as long as you keep that not desire for any outcome, paradise will just stay there. Will just stay. And you'll very soon, though, choose a new idea. You know, the idea of not trying to be prime creator. And at some point, the dream doesn't even need to appear for you at all. You see. But that, we don't even need to talk about that. That's the final step. But it is literally true. And I used to say a resurrection of bodies can't possibly happen. Actually, it can. If belief would back off enough, everything would reverse. You know, all the stuff would happen. It's like it would like be, to, you know, it's just a dream here. And in a dream, anything at all can happen. It can reverse time, can back off, all sorts of stuff. Nothing is set in this dream, really. Nothing. It seems to be, but it's not. That's why people could go to an ambassador of reality like Jesus, be healed like that. Why? Because they, for a moment, they gave up any prayer, expectation, desire for any consequences whatsoever. It was suspended. And in that moment, belief had to back off. Said, whoa, something threatening to the dream. The dream's totally threatened here. We got to back off this destructive trap that we're, scenario, this whole trap we've devised. And in backing off, we have to back off the sickness. And people were healed of, boom, like that, of anything. Leprosy, blindness, cancer, you name it. Like that. Gone. That's very, very true. That's what will happen when you suspend the desire for any outcome whatsoever. Belief has to back off. And some will do it just for a moment, you know, and they'll experience some kind of miracle, you know. It's just belief backing off. If you really suspend it, you awaken from the dream, and you see, and then you experience the dreamer, you know who you are, which is way better than a miracle, that is for sure. Miracles are just little moments of suspending desire for any outcome. And your life softens up, you know, you recover your health, you recover your finances, everything seems to be getting better and better and better as belief backs away from all this threat scenario until it can figure out how to, you know, fool you better. And then you keep doing this, that at some point you just decide, I'm not going to pray for any consequence, outcome whatsoever, and you're totally okay with that, you're very okay with it, and then you will realize, who the dreamer is. Say, I am the dreamer. I've been dreaming this, and you'll experience your true identity, and then that's the goal. That is the goal. And then you will literally be in that condition of knowing for sure none of this is consequential. You don't have to. It's effortless. It becomes effortless at that point. And then miracles happen around you all the time. As people come in contact with you, they get this feeling and they give up their desire for outcomes for a moment, and their whole situation softens up as well. And that's when people can get healed, you know, just like that, boom. It's automatic. The thing softens up, and it softens up in different ways. So not everybody gets healed from a sickness or their finances. It softens up in different ways for different people, depending on how belief is configuring, you know, the trap that is trying to deal, you know, work with you, and how it's trying to trick you specifically, and all the different pragmatic details. It'll back off those. So somehow you'll feel some softening, you know. Like in my instance, the softening is the capacity to say these things, whereas before I couldn't say these things. I knew it, I couldn't say it. Could not. Too much anxiety, too much terror. But now I'm able to say it. That's a profound softening of belief. Belief has had to back off, has had to back away from me. But my health, you know, is still, my health is okay. I just have no energy. So my fatigue, my stress, my finances, a lot of stuff is still, you know, terrible. But there's a certain area that has softened up, you see. And maybe at some point the other stuff will soften up too. So the softening up is, you know, different in every case. It's different in every case. If you have like a sickness, it won't necessarily disappear on you. But in some people, the situation is so tied up to an illness that when they give up praying for any outcome and outcomes, the illness will just go. It'll just go. I mean, there are people, you know, who've been going in there, get ready to go into surgery with some severe condition, and the surgeon will get in there, and there's nothing, that it's all well, like that. The surgeon will say, what happened? It's unbelievable. It's a miracle. Yeah. You know, that they call it a miracle. You know, the term miracle is just a generalized term, but nobody really knows what it means. It means this belief had to back away. This whole dream scenario, this very tricky dream, had to back away from the situation because it felt threatened. You're going to wake up. He says, uh-oh. They don't know what awakening is. This dream doesn't understand what awakening is. It only feels that there's a threat to the dream. And when it feels this threat, it panics and says, oh gosh, I got to back away. I don't want this threat. Something terrible is going to happen. I'm going to be annihilated. And then it backs away and says, I need to imagine a healthy body right this moment. Because somehow imagining this sick body was leading to this terrible threat that something's going to be annihilated. So it says, I got to back away and have a healthy body. Boom. And I can back away in an instant. Because it's all imagination. This whole thing. So anything can happen instantaneously here. Anything. Anything at all. But what it does is simply backs away, you know, based on what, you know, a strategy. So it does, you know, the world is not chaotic. Not like that. But the backing away then brings what we call miracles. So someone can touch the hem of Jesus, you know, cloak, and boom, their illness is gone like that. Now, of course, it will come back at some point if they don't awaken from the dream. But temporarily, there's this reprieve. I mean, Lazarus was raised from the grave, you know, but at some other point, he may have died. So the point is that when you get a reprieve, when things soften up, don't say, oh, God answered my prayer. All my prayers, I've been praying for a better outcome. God answered my prayer. That just brings it right back to you. What you should be saying is saying, oh, when I gave up praying for any outcome whatsoever here, belief backed away from this whole threat scenario, and I was I'm in a condition now of what they call grace or non-threat, you know, much less invulnerability. I'm still dreaming, but in much less invulnerability. And they say, okay, let me awaken from the dream entirely here by not even, you know, keep praying for no outcome. Then you'll awaken. But what's happened is people get these moments of miracles. They get well, they say, then they, you know, build temples and shrines and places of pilgrimage and worship, and they worship the God and say, God, you saved me from this awful illness. Please save my brothers and my sisters. Can't we all get well? I'm praying for this person. I'm lighting a candle. I'm praying for them. And it's the whole business of religion, you know, as it goes on all over the world. It just makes things worse, and it brings the sickness right back. Because the belief says, ah, gotcha. Now you're praying for an outcome. See, it's exactly what belief wants, praying for an outcome. But those who get wise to it, they say, they know, aha, I know what's going on here. I got well because I wasn't praying for an outcome. And this wellness is still a dream, you see. Because the isness, the wellness is meaningless to isness. Because wellness is a duality. Wellness is the one side of the coin to sickness, non-wellness, all this stuff. Everything about the body is meaningless to isness. Isness is not a body. It can't be sick. It can't be vulnerable. So why even talk about wellness? It has no concept of wellness. It is no concepts at all. It has no concepts. Reality doesn't carry any concepts because concepts are dualistic. You know, wellness as opposed to non-wellness. Life as opposed to death. Those are all dualistic concepts. So, people, you know, the idea of trying to give miracles to people, no. It can make things worse. Because they might ascribe it to all their prayers finally were answered. And now they're going to pray even more for more positive outcomes for everybody else. They say, I'm going to sit down and pray for the whole world that all illness be, you know, gotten rid of, that God heals everybody from every illness. And then that just totally drags them down in deeper delusion. What you should pray for is, I pray that everyone in the world pray for no outcome. And I'm not even praying for this outcome to take place. But, you know, you understand what it is you're praying for. That everyone realize and pray that there be no outcome to take place here whatsoever, none. That prayer will not drag you down. You see, the ambassadors of reality, such as Anonymai Ma, she wasn't praying for any outcome here. She never prayed for any outcome. They'd ask her to. You say, Ma, everyone in Bangladesh, you know, is dying. I mean, in East Bengal at that time is, you know, suffering from starving to death. Everyone's starving to death, which is true. I don't know, anywhere from 2 to 6 million people starved to death. It was horrible. One of those periodic famines in the Indian subcontinent, you know, which were very, very nasty. And it was middle-class people that starved to death, actually. Farmers, they could, you know, somehow survive with their chickens and, you know, some way get by, have some land. And the wealthy people had enough money to buy what the meager supplies there were, but they couldn't afford to hire the middle class, so the middle class was left destitute and just starved to death. And they would say, a lot of the people were from the middle class, you know, and they knew their relatives were all starving to death, you know. People, they knew, all these people, they knew them. And they said, you know, this is horrible. Can you please pray for our people, my relatives, our family? They're dying. They don't have anything. Pray for them, please, Ma, pray. And she'd just, you know, sit there and bless and wouldn't say anything. And she wouldn't pray. She wouldn't pray for them. And people took that like, wow, you know, you're really wonderful, but it seems like, you know, you're lacking in compassion or humanity. And she said, no, that's not true. You're not, you don't understand. You don't understand. But she wouldn't pray like that. They say, Ma, World War II, everybody's been getting killed. If you just pray, it would end. And she says, no. There's no war. There's nothing bad happening. There's nothing for, you know, I'm not praying for any consequences at all, any consequences in particular at all, nothing. I'm not praying for the famine to end. I'm not praying for it to continue. I'm not praying for it to get worse. I'm not praying for any particular outcome whatsoever. You know, people had a hard time with that, very hard time. But it's amazing that someone in this world can have that clarity and attitude when, you know, all the devotees, you know, are saying, please, our families, you know, our relatives are dying, they're starving to death, they're getting killed, you know, and she wouldn't even pray for any outcome like that, including those who were serving in the Kali Mandir in Ramna Park when the massacre occurred in, what was it, 71 or something? I don't know, I can't remember the date exactly, but anyway, it was the War of Liberation, and her devotees there were massacred, you know, and you would have thought that she would have prayed for a different outcome for them, but apparently not at all. It's like, wow, and really not praying for any outcome at all here in this world. See, our conception of these great saviors is that they're here to pray for a positive outcome for us. But the truth is just the opposite. They're here to pray that we give up our desire for any outcome that take place here. They're here to show us that the prayer is a prayer of not desiring any outcome or consequences here at all. That's what they're here for. Because they're here to awaken us from this dream. Not to change the outcomes or consequences of the dream. That makes it worse. It makes it worse. Now, through the grace of not praying for any consequences, the dream does soften. So things did soften, but not because she was praying for any change in consequences. Simply for the grace here causes belief. Belief has no choice but to soften up the dream, soften up the threat, soften up the suffering, soften up the dying. Has to do all that. And has no choice. Has to back away from this, you know, vicious, constant devouring of itself. Has to back away because it feels very threatened. Very threatened. So, by not praying for any consequences, she actually helped a great deal. But it doesn't back away from everyone in the same way. And some people who are so addicted to praying for consequences, it may not back away much for them, you see. And they may end up getting massacred. So, grace, the action of God's grace in this world is not what we have expected or believe in. Again, there's belief. What we've believed is not so. There's not some Savior going to come down and pray for a change in consequences for us. Just the opposite. They're going to pray that we pray for no change in consequences, no outcome, not desiring any outcome, not even desiring that it stays the same either. Not that it changes, gets better, not that it gets better, not that it gets worse, not that it stay the same, neutral. Neutral on all of it. Just a total, perfect, pure neutrality. And with that, you cannot keep dreaming. It's impossible. You have to awaken from the dream at that point. Awakening is completely assured. And it doesn't even have to be 100% neutral, you know. I don't know how that works exactly. But you have to be more neutral than not, you know. You have to be okay with neutrality, with that. And you have to be at a point where you don't use the awakening to somehow confirm that your prayers for a change in outcome were answered. Because if you do that, things get worse. They get worse. Because then you start praying even more for changes in outcome. Then you think you got the power. Then you think you got the power of healing. Think you're a healer. You say, I can heal other people too. Wow, I healed myself, I can heal others. And then you start praying for their sickness to get better, and their sickness to get better, and their sickness to get better. And then you are really getting dragged down into delusion, and you will find yourself getting very sick at some point. Being a severe attack that will generate even greater desire to pray for an outcome. It's a vicious circle here. This dream is a vicious circle. That is true. It pulls you down, and you spiral down and down and down into deeper and deeper delusion here in the dream. That is a fact. And the more you pray for others' healing, your own healing and then others' healing, the more you're getting pulled down on this vicious cycle, which is why you often see healers succumbing very severely to terrible illnesses. Happened to one of my doctors, actually. And, they were a great healer. And they were trying to, they were renowned for healing, everybody. They're very good at it. And they died very young, very, very tragically, very terrible. He wasn't able to heal me because I wasn't really praying, to be healed, so, or maybe I was, and that kept me from getting well, just from some stress, not being able to sleep. That's basically the only problem I've had is simply too much stress, not being able to sleep. My mind is trying to figure out, how can I work with this belief system? How can I work with belief? And that just causes, just a nightmare. Because you cannot work with belief. That's a problem. You cannot. And I was, I felt like I needed to because no one would believe what I was saying. Because what I say is beyond belief. And so I figured, if I really want to help people, I got to figure a way to what I say is not beyond belief. Because everybody here only is in belief. And so I was trying to figure out a way to do that. And that just caused my mind to be constantly working, and then I couldn't sleep because I said, I almost got it. I got to keep working, got to keep thinking. And then stress leads to, all sorts of your immune system goes bad, and you get all sorts of sicknesses. You're dragged down. It's terrible. But the way to do that is to realize you cannot work with belief. You just simply have to say what's beyond belief, and then it's up to the world to either accept it or not. But you can say it in a way that is, people feel okay about it, okay with it. Just have to do it. And, it was, when you're young, it's very intimidating. It's very difficult for people to come into this world, for anyone to come into this world and maintain the truth here as they're young. It's very difficult. Because the desire to fit into society and to help others. A child says, I just want to, you know, give what my gift that I have brought in, and it seems nobody will take it from me, and you feel like I just need to find some way that they'll take it from me. So very few have come into this world and maintain their perfect awakeness from the day of birth all the way through. Ananamaima was one of those. But it's very difficult. So usually we are enmeshed in trying to figure out a way for belief to accept what truth. And belief can't accept truth. And we have to accept that fact. Belief will not accept it. Cannot. So there is no way. There is no way to convince belief of truth. Impossible. Because belief believes that reality can be changed, which means truth can be changed, which means to belief there is no truth. There's only belief. Belief believes it is a higher authority than truth, because it believes it knows the changes that are going to come to truth, and truth seems to be unaware of it. So belief thinks that it's higher, you know. What a little spider. Something there. Okay, go over there. So the way to, you know, to lessen the stress is to be able to speak the truth here and not expect belief to believe it, and be okay with that. Be okay with it. And that's the only way I've been able to lessen the stress, because I had to deliver this message, this truth. That's my purpose, and if I couldn't deliver it, I would just be frantically trying to figure out how to deliver it. So by delivering it, that takes the stress off of me. You know, of course, I know that belief has made, you know, doesn't believe me. It cannot. So why stress about that? But everybody here can believe. Not can believe, I'm sorry. Everybody here can know. Everybody here in the world can know what's being said is true. Everyone. Because everyone is spirit, is isness, is, and it knows, intuitively knows this. It's the only belief is out of the loop. Belief is out of the loop, inherently out of the loop. You can't bring it into the loop. I thought there was some way, you know, just be an artful enough approach, you could bring a belief into the loop. You cannot do it. Nobody can. Nobody ever be able to do that. If it were possible, the ambassadors of reality would have already done it. They would have done it like that. We wouldn't even be here. And belief says, well, they weren't perfect, otherwise they would have done it. Not true. There have been perfect ambassadors of reality, and they can't do that. Belief cannot know truth. It's impossible. So we have to awaken from the dream. We can't be happy in the dream. We can't be happy with belief. Belief denies reality. Belief is trying to figure a way out to destroy reality. How can we be happy in such a dream? We cannot. And belief just keeps telling us to wait. And eventually it will get it. No, it will never get it. So we have to, again, pray for no particular outcome whatsoever. No outcome whatsoever. No desire for any particular outcome at all. Not staying the same, not getting better, not getting worse. Don't pray for the same. Neutral. Have no desire for any particular outcome at all. Pray that way. Pray that way, and then you will be beyond belief. You'll go beyond belief. You'll go beyond time. You won't need the past or the future. You'll awaken from the dream. And as you go do that, you'll probably have miracles, which are just the softening of the dream for you, the backing away from the threat. You'll feel less threatened. You'll feel less threatened. That is the truth. That is what has happened to me. I can testify to that. I used to feel very threatened because I felt like if I spoke the truth, I knew the truth, if I spoke it, I was going to be attacked. The whole world was going to attack me. So it's very, very frightening. And now I don't feel that way. I don't feel like I'm going to be attacked. Okay, because I'm clear about the situation, and belief has to back away. It has to back away. You know, it thinks that by backing away, it'll attack me in the future, definitely. But what it doesn't know is that in the so-called future, it'll have to back away even more. See, it doesn't realize that. It just says, okay, I can't attack him now, but I'm going to get him later. I say, okay, you know, whatever. It won't get me later either. So the feeling of threat does back away. It backs away. However that threat is, however you're feeling it, you know, for whatever reason, if it's financial, if it's health, all that stuff, the feeling has to back away from you. So I'm at the point now where I can say these things and not feel threatened, which is incredible. Incredible, because before, there's no way in the world I could say these things. No way. Because the feeling of threat was so extreme. Terror, absolute terror, extreme threat. Just because it goes beyond belief and completely, you know, dismisses all of what belief believes in as actually making things worse and this very diabolical dualistic trap. And I thought for sure belief was going to come in and just destroy me for saying it, but no, belief can't do that because what I am is feels very threatening to belief. Belief is terrified of me, you know, and says we got to back away and figure out a better way to attack this guy, you know. That's what happens. That's what'll happen in your life. Whatever. You know, however, the feeling of threat will ease up as you hear, as you listen to these videos. It'll ease up on you. It'll literally ease up on you. And it'll be a subtle thing. And just one day you'll gradually realize, wow, I'm able to see it this way, and I don't feel like I'm threatened. Wow. And then you'll say, oh my gosh, there's something really working here. There's a principle at work here that's very, totally profound. It's the principle of awakening. It's the principle of awakening. Okay. Well, I don't know. Every day, momentum keeps going. It's amazing. It's fantastic. It has to be that way, right? Because the clock is ticking. The clock is ticking as the world's getting very close to this profound call to action, which means call to changing consequences, changing outcomes in the dream. There will be an intense, how would you call it? A massive outbreak, an intense outbreak of this mindset, this belief we need to change the outcomes in this dream. And if you are not aligned with this type of teaching, which is a stream of grace from the ambassadors of reality, you will get swept up in that trying to change outcomes in the dream, and you will make it worse for yourself. You'll end up feeling more threatened. So it's super important that those who want to awaken from this dream catch this breeze, you know, put up their sails. When you're watching the video, you're putting up your sail. And when you have your sail up, you're catching this breeze, catching the breeze. Breeze is coming. You say, yeah, that's not so bad. It's not tearing the boat apart. It's fine. It's not a problem. It's not a problem for me. It's not a problem from you. For you. I don't feel threatened. You don't feel threatened. Belief has to back away. The whole belief system has to back away. For me, it has to back away from you, too. That's how it works. So actually, what's going to happen is the situation is going to become better and better and better and better and better for us. For those who want to awaken, it's going to become better and better and better. Really. Big time. Has to. It has to. And we'll just ride that momentum, you know, of awakening. Not praying for any outcome whatsoever, but realizing that the dream does back away from us. Does soften up. That's an inevitable consequence of it. But don't pray for others that, you know, that whatever good you're getting, that God, you got to give them the good too. No, pray that they pray for no outcome, any particular outcome or consequence. And that'll automatically, that's what will give them, you know, the softening too. Okay, so you put it in the right context, and your softening will continue up, continue, continue, continue. Eventually, you'll end up in paradise, really. It's an incredibly beautiful situation. And then from there, you'll actually end up awakening entirely to your identity of isness, which is beyond anything we can even talk about, really. Okay. And you will choose a new idea, and you feel this unconditional love, and the peace and tranquility will be beyond belief, beyond belief. That's a fact. And you're just, right now the dream is softening up. It's backing away. The dynamics are backing away in their intensity. The dynamic of threat, which is what this dream is backing away from you. The dynamic of threat, the feeling of threat, is backing away because you are considering you're okay with not praying for any particular consequence. It's not good, not bad, not the same. You're indifferent to it all. You're indifferent to any consequence, good, bad, or the same. Indifferent. There's a high indifference. Okay. Fantastic. Awesome. Very great. This is October momentum, which I promised you I would give. So I'm making good on that promise here. October momentum is here. All right. Very great. That's it for this video. I'm going to now listen to these little crickets and cicadas and stuff, giving their nice little symphony, you know. Beautiful evening. Okay, that's it.